In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh
woke this morning in an awful fright. I dreamed that Yahweh took it out last night. I wasn't standing where I should have been. He said, you know you knew better. You knew it was the end. Saw my brethren all dressed in white. They didn't know me as I stood there and cried. I knew the tears would run down forever. There was no sound of glory for me, just the sound of His displeasure. But when I did awake, I was in a full sweat. I took a moment out to catch my breath. 'Cause when you dream about that lake of fire, you just wanna know more and more to be all He desires. Yes, when I did awake, I was so relieved to see the sun smiling through my window like His Son smiling at me. Oh, when I did awake, I was so relieved to see there was still some chance for me. Brother, What a nightmare. You really had to be there. When I did awake, I was so relieved to see the sun smiling through my window like his son smiling at me. Oh, when I did awake, I was so relieved to see there was still some chance for me. Brother, what a night. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Good morning, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Galatians, the 4th chapter, page 253. And I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Galatians, the 4th chapter, page 253. Now I say that the heirs, as long as he is a child, differ nothing from a servant, though he be owner of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of the time was come, Yahweh sent forth his son, made of a woman, made subject to the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, Yahweh has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father, Abba, my Father. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of Yahweh through the Messiah. Howbeit then, when ye knew not Yahweh, ye did service unto them which by nature are nothing but idols. But now, after that ye have known Yahweh, or rather are known of Yahweh, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto ye desire again to be in bondage? Ye observe days and months and times and years. I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye are. Ye have not injured me at all. Ye know how through infirmities of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at the first. And my weakness which was in my flesh ye despised not, nor rejected, but receive me as an angel of Elohim, even as the Messiah Yahshua. Where is then the blessedness ye spake of? For I bear you record that if it had been possible, ye would have plucked out your own eyes and have given them to me. Am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? They are zealous towards you, but not for your good. They would exclude us that ye might be zealous for them. But it is good to be zealously affected always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again unto the Messiah be formed in you. I desire to be present with you now and to change my voice, for I stand in doubt of you. Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do ye not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. Which things are an allegory?
For these are the two covenants, the one from the Mount Sinai, which generates to bondage, which is Hagar. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, Sing, O barren, thou that didst not bear, break forth into singing and cry aloud, thou that didst not travail with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married wife. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even as it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free woman. I have read Galatians, the 4th chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. for our first speaker for today's lecture, I would like to call Dr. Aaron Alanese.
Hello, all right. Morning.
Morning.
always an honor to be up here. Share a little about what has been shown to me. First time being called on a Sunday, which is pretty cool. First of all, it's crazy out there. Out there in the world, when you're just even just trying to mind your own business and stay on track and stay focused, and not be overcome with emotion, the feelings, the mystery of iniquity trying to trick you with these thoughts of negativity and trying to curse this or trying to blame that for our problems. Or personally, I've done it plenty of times. I still struggle with finding someone to blame. I don't blame anyone. I don't blame Yahweh. I don't blame any of that. I used to have that problem. I do have a problem sometimes with instantly when something happens, I do have that, whose fault is it? Who is it? My fault? Is it? When really, it's no one's fault. It's no one's agenda but Yahweh's. Mm-hmm. And that gives me comfort and peace in that storm. There are many people who I encounter with my daily activities that don't have that understanding, and even people who've been in class, who I've brought to class and I've talked to, they still don't have that understanding and that grasp, and it really shows when you get overwhelmed. Again, and I want to comparing it to myself, though. From when I first came in here, I remember I could have just, at the smallest thing, tripped up and went back into old habits, old feelings, traditional things. Even a good example of that is like when we learn about the names, and some people will know about, you know, Yahweh, and they'll accept it, but then they'll go back to things that are more comfortable to them because they get back around the people who make it makes them feel comfortable. They want to maybe fit in a little bit more, so they conform again, and they go back to using things of the world, such as Jesus Christ, and things that maybe they didn't know before they came down to this class, but when they do come down to this class, they learn those things, and they still struggle with it. They still struggle to get past these names, or the two names, which is only really one name, Yahweh, and then Yahweh is salvation, and then the one title. And people get tripped up about that all the time. And recently, Eunice has been going over it beautifully, and I really truly enjoyed what Yahshua has been using you to bring out, because it has been beautiful. And so we've been spending a lot of time recently about these names. I even had a discussion with my mother recently, and she's getting into, I don't want to get too into it because she's going to get into it, but of how the examples of the feminine portion of Yahweh. And I just thought that was great, because though there are these big esoteric things that we can bring out with this, just something as simple as the names. It's the smallest chart in here, I think. Well, I mean, the 40 plate charts are smaller, but it really, this is quite a small chart compared to what we got in here. So, I mean, it's even over here off to the side and in the corner. Not that we're trying to hide it or anything, but compared to everything else, it might get overlooked as not important. But this is what started all of this, the writings for this. Because before that time, they only knew of a El Shaddai, another title but they didn't have a name. They didn't have any full-on relationship, because how could you if you don't have that name? When you introduce yourself to someone, you're introducing the name, and even when you introduce your name, a lot comes with that name. I mean, we go over how Yahshua said, "I will come in my Father's name," and we point out the Yah and the Yah, and how it totally takes out Jesus from being in the running for even maybe being the name. Plus, not only that, but the letter J only being in existence for about 600 years in the English language. So, but we're talking about original languages when this was written, Hebrew, Latin, and Greek, I believe, and none of those had any characters or letters that would make the sound that the letter J makes. I actually looked it up. It was, oh man, I think it was an Italian scholar who invented it, and because it was, they wanted to make a distinction between the letter I and the letter J, and he and or the and that sound. Sorry, there was no letter J, but the I sound and the J sound. So he came up with this J symbol, and it still looks like an I, a lowercase J has that, and that, and then that's an I. So you can see just by looking at it how similar they are. But something as simple as that can be a stumbling block for someone. Something as simple as speech, something as simple as garb, these things can become stumbling blocks for some people. But once you study a bit, once you start learning about some principles and something solid, something that is steeped in truth and in fact and something tangible, like this 3-in-1 configuration, because it only shows spirit law in effect and in how Yahweh is three form but one spirit, two manifestations but one spirit. Because Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this form, he cannot be understood. He cannot be perceived. But he is the all and all. Mm-hmm. He needs nothing outside of himself to do anything. We have it written on this chart over here, below all this, Ea, Asher, Ea. Translated, I will be what I will to be. And it's funny that, because this is three right here. One, two, three. One, two, three. Just even saying the phrase, I will be what I will to be, is three form. I will be what I will to be. Three. Just like this tabernacle pattern that was shown to Moses in the vision of the creation, when he transformed from his Eloistic shape, superincorporeal form, into this fully furnished tabernacle pattern. Now that's important. It was fully furnished. Didn't need anything added. Didn't need anything taken away. Perfect from the get-go. Having everything that it needed right within itself. Was already operating. Was not like, hey, I need you to step in so you can take over this and operate it. No, it's already operating. It's already going. You need nothing more than to learn about it and to talk about it to anyone and everyone who's willing to listen. And not for their understanding, not for anyone's understanding but your own. Because when it comes down to it, at the end, every tub must stand on its own, what is it, feet?
Bottom.
Bottom. Or feet.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone will have to answer for themselves, is the point. I won't be able to be like, hey, Marlon, what was the answer to that? Hey, Sean, what was that again? Remember when we went over there in class? No. We have that now. That's the opportunity we have now to get these questions out, to get the studying in, to prepare. You don't know you're going to the championships and not practice. You don't just show up at the final game. You have all these little games. You have all these other scrimmages and practices that you have to go through before you get there. But the good thing is when you figure out that it's a fixed fight and that you're going to get there already because you're on the path, man, do those scrimmages and those losses and the things that feel like losses, do they just feel like gifts? They become assets. The things that we stumbled over before, the things that used to get in our way, now become clear obstacles to avoid and to use as assets and I won't say allow, because the only reason I say allow is because we let our egos get in the way. So once we figure out how to let Yahweh remove that ego and work with us and mold us what he sees fit, not until then will we get there, because it's going to be Yahweh, Yahshua, doing everything on his time. So just like how I would like to just know everything there is about this teaching right from the get-go, I can't. It's because it's not up to me. But I am grateful and I am proud of the things that have been shown to me so far. And that is why I can get up here and speak about these things. I can only speak about what I know. And these are the things that I've been shown about how we have witnesses in heaven, which I gave you, which was the Father, the Word or Son, which is Elohim, and the Holy Spirit, which is Yahshua, in or out of a physical body. And then we also have three witnesses on earth that agree in one, which is a principle of blood, a principle of water, and a principle of spirit. Now, we've been given these things to try to give us somewhat of an understanding of our Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Because like I said, in his pure spirit state, you can't understand it. Though we have these nine principle attributes written on here of wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength, which we just went over a couple classes ago, though we have those things up here, that's not the all in all that make up pure spirit. Just like it didn't take the all in all of pure spirit to create the creation. Because, again, it didn't take all of Yahweh pure spirit, only in part, to come into this super incorporeal being, who in turn willed the creation that we walk around in right now. And that creation also dwells within the realm of eternity. And within the realm of eternity, there is no measure of time like how we perceive time now. Everything's happening at once. Everything is already finished. We're just living it out and playing it out. That Yahweh's already written, directed, edited it, and put it out for us to watch, and we're just watching it. We're the characters in his play. Mm-hmm. The whole Bible, this book, has nothing to do with you, has nothing to do with me, has nothing to do with anyone other than Yahshua the Messiah. That's who this is all pointing towards. That's who we're all here to talk about. That's what we're here to learn about. The purpose, pattern, and plan. And when I say pattern, there's a pattern. Like I said, that was in operation, right? Well, if you read, believe it's an Exodus of the workings of this, the Exodus and Leviticus, right? Throughout. Of the workings and function of this pattern, and how the high priest had to navigate this pattern, and once Yahweh gives you the understanding, man, do these charts come alive, and you see this pattern moving and working, and then you start looking in the mirror and see it moving and working. We have, like I said, a 3-in-1 configuration of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round bout. Okay? And then in this 3-in-1 configuration, we have 7 steps, which is the gate, the brazen altar of sin sacrifice, the brazen laver of water, the door, which is the 4th step. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, which you would get the holy cup of anointing oil poured over you before entering into the holy place, which is the 5th step, the whole holy place. Now, before I go into that, I just want to point out how the first 3 steps, or the brazen altar of sin sacrifice, the brazen laver of water, and how the holy cup of anointing oil, or the door, correlate with this blood principle, because the blood represents, can also be a death. Now, when, is there, oh, right here, okay. When they would have to do a sacrifice, they would have, for breaking one of these cardinal ordinances that the children of Israel back then were given in the wilderness of Sinai, and them alone, whenever they broke one of these, it was like breaking all of them. But each one that they broke, a specific one they broke, had a specific animal that had to be sacrificed to take their place, a scapegoat, if you will. And that sacrifice would have to be put on this brazen altar of sin offering. And the blood of that sacrifice would have to be put on the four horns of this altar, showing the blood principle. Then we have a water principle, which you can clearly see the water right here, the brazen laver of water. Pretty simple, but this is where the high priest and the two low priests would wash their feet before entering into the holy place, the holy place, because they would have to take off their shoes before they entered in. Now, this spirit correlates with this holy cup of anointing or quickening, because the spirit allows that quickening. And I can still be over here. So once we enter in at the door, which is four, then we go to the most the holy place, which is the fifth step, which has the 12 loaves of bread on the table of shewbread, the golden candle lampstand, and the golden altar of incense. Then you would move on to the sixth step, which is the second compartmental veil, which it looks better over here. It's a little easier to see. Which would actually cover the most holy place. And then the high priest and the high priest alone was the only one allowed to enter into this most holy place. The two low priests were allowed to enter in right here at the holy place, and were able to partake in the eating of the table of the bread, because it helps sustain them. Just like how the bread is the gospel, or is the doctrine which is taught to give us sustenance and give us energy and power which to go forth. I know I backed up a little bit, but it's important to point these things out. And then the seven branch candle lampstand provided light, which the tabernacle was never without light. It would be lit at 3 in the afternoon, and then put out at 9 in the morning, and then. But from those times that it wasn't lit, the sun was shining in here and giving it light and illumination. The S-O-N, but it points to the S, or the S-U-N, which points to the S-O-N. Mm-hmm. And then you had the two low priests, and the first two low priests were Nadab and Abihu. Aaron's two sons. Mm-hmm. And the first high priest was Aaron, mm-hmm. Moses' brother. they were given a specific mixture of incense in which to put into this altar of incense. And it's in the stories where they tried to put their own mixture in and were struck dead instantly. Mm-hmm. And because Aaron had understanding, he was okay with it. He was, don't get me wrong, he's pretty sure he was like, oh man, my sons. But when it came down to it, it was Yahweh's will. He knew they messed up. He went forward. So you have the sixth step, which is the second compartment of El. Then you have the seventh step, which is the Ark of the which is the most holy place, which had the Ark of the Covenant, which is a 3-in-1 furnishing, right? Configuration, which is the Ark of the Covenant with the two archangels overlooking the mercy seat, where the cloud would sit upon and dwell amongst the people. The cloud representing Yahweh Elohim. And then the eye right here is representing of the flesh, the Shekinah, which is the understanding or the ascension, if you will. So all these things make up this one tabernacle pattern, and all these things are functioning right within you and everything you see. And these are all important principles and important facts that you need to research and make solid for yourself. I can be up here all day talking about as much as I know, but what it comes down is to what you know and for your satisfaction. Again, it's always an honor to be up here. It's never what any of the speakers who get up here, it's never what they want to say. You can come up here with an agenda all you want, but if you're trying to speak the truth and you know the truth is going to come out whether you like it or not. Because you're not in control. Yahweh is in control. And he's controlling everything from what you think to your breathing. Mm-hmm. And with those few short words, I hope someone got something out of that. And if they did, all praises be to Yahshua the Messiah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Alaniz. I will be your second speaker for today. We're going to have a 3-speaker format, so I'll take a little bit of time and let somebody else finish up. I truly do appreciate the foundation that the previous speaker gave, and it's definitely a privilege and an honor to be able to stand before the assembly of the body of Yahshua the Messiah and speak anything that I've come to know and understand about this teaching. And one of the things that stood out to me that Dr. Alaniz was talking about was the origins of the letter J. And right here I have it's a replica of the 1611 King James Version Bible. And just to give you a confirmation there that there were no J's. And the moderation has said that the letter J didn't exist even in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Now, this is 1611, so this is this is within that time frame, and you see it's Prince Iames if you zoom in here, and you have, if you can see that right there, I don't know if you can get in on that, but if you see it, Jesus is with an I here in this rendition of the King James Bible. So the J actually came in where there were two I's placed next to each other, and that hook originated before it even got its sound that Dr. Alaniz was talking about. Before it even got that sound of the J, the hook came in to denote that there were two I's placed right next to each other. And it so-called evolved from there. And these are things that you should take your time and do your own investigation on to prove those things for yourself, to edify yourself. There's scripture that says, study to show yourself approved, rightfully dividing the word of truth. Now, we say here in this school that you can't work up on this thing. And it is true. If you read Romans 1:19 and 20, it says, go ahead and get that.
Romans 1:19. Mm-hmm. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
It's manifest in you. What you may know of Yahweh is manifest in you. It's put in you. Read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Yahweh has showed it unto them. And that's what I want right there. See, you can't work up on this thing, but you can study to show yourself approved, to make sure that you have the truth. Because if you don't have the truth, you need to keep on asking. You need to keep praying. You ought to pray for that. You ought to ask for that understanding. You know, it says there's other scriptures that says seek him while he may be found. Mm-hmm. And if you studying and you can't show yourself approved, and you still got some seeking to do. And I'll tell you, as long as we have these physical bodies on, you're going to continue seeking, because there's also another scripture that says we're going to go on to learn in ages to come. So it's an impossibility for us to know all of everything here in the flesh. Speaking of the flesh, I was invited to go to a Zoom class with Meridian not too long ago, and they were having a workshop of sorts where you pick a couple of definitions and you go through the explanation of it. And I thought it was very, really edifying to be able to do that, because under normal circumstances we get up on the floor and we speak on what we know, and we don't go and do direct research on a particular specific subject to present on the floor. We just speak what's on our heart and mind, and we get down and let the next speaker go. But with the workshops, it's a little bit different. And I chose a couple of words, one of the words being idolatry. And I was surprised to come to the understanding that I did just through going through the research of idolatry, and how the root word of idolatry is an idol. And when I broke down what an idol was, I mean, it's anything that you basically can perceive and you give reverence to or look up to in any kind of way. You can look at yourself in the mirror. and make that an idol. You can have a car in the garage and make that an idol. You know, whatever it is that you worship, like they got this golden calf out here. This is an example of an idol. Now, if you want to zoom out and look at this chart, you worship this chart and don't understand what this chart is. You just worship this chart, and that's an idol. No matter what's all on this chart, this ain't Yahweh right here. This is a pictorial illustration of the attributes of Yahweh. You worship this chart and you put your salvation on this chart. That is idolatry. And in my explanation, I used the Big Bang Theory as an idea or an example of an idol, because there are very intelligent minds out there who study science. They don't believe in God or what have you. And all they believe in is science. And you've got this theory of the Big Bang, and it correlates a lot with the creation by the pattern. But it doesn't explain the source of the bang, where the bang came from. I used to appreciate Will Williams when he got on the floor. He used to talk about that particular thing, is that they would go all the way back to the bang, but they didn't know where the bang came from. And you know, I was just going through that explanation of idolatry and seeing how they worship that theory, how they worship that concept of something, but they don't have the power. Where is the scripture where it says they have a form of worship, but they deny the power thereof? Okay. Yeah, if you can get that for me, my book will fall all apart if I pick it up.
Okay. Second Timothy.
Go ahead and read.
3:5.
Mm-hmm.
Having a form of the worship of Yahweh, but denying the power thereof.
Can you pick it up a little bit at the beginning of the train of thought?
Okay.
This is a couple verses.
For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasterers, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truth breakers, mm-hmm. false accuser, incontinence, fierce, despiser of those that are good,
right.
traitors, heady, high-minded, mm-hmm. lovers of pleasure more than lovers of Yahweh.
And you can't tell me you can't see that out in the world right now with the people that you deal with on a day-to-day basis. I know I do. I'm just speaking for myself. But go ahead and read.
Having a form of the worship of Yahweh, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away.
They have a form. See, and that's what you have with the Big Bang Theory. You have a form of the worship. You know that something's right about how, you know, once that explosion occurred, everything started expanding on out, and there's a pattern by which everything started expanding out. And once you got that pattern, the scientists see the patterns there. They don't understand this pattern, how it is and actually exists. They just know that there's a pattern. They know that everything goes by is threefold. But they don't understand the steps. They don't understand all of the furnishings and how these furnishings that were given to Moses to build in a vision in the Mount Sinai, how they correlate, how this is a type and shadow to show back to the Spirit and how we are made in His likeness and image. Okay? In His likeness. Okay, can you continue reading there?
6. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sin, led away with various lusts.
They creep into houses. And see, when I read that, I realize that Yahweh dwells in temples not made with man's hands. And this physical body that I'm walking around. I'm burdened to carry around with me everywhere and deal with, wash up, bathe, whatever. This is a house. This is in the likeness and image. This is made in the likeness and image of Yahweh. When you read over in Genesis, with the second chapter, he said, let us make man in his likeness and image. In our likeness and image. I'm sorry. Let us make man in our likeness and image. Now, Yahweh is a unity, and these three are one. There's no separation here. So when you've got an idol, you're looking right here, but you're not giving the credit and reverence to that, how these two are necessary for this to even take place, to even be going on. You missing the point. You're looking at it, but it's there. But you don't know it because of that veil that you got right here, that veil of the flesh that covers up the reality that Yahweh is running the whole show. And that's what we got going on here with idolatry and people being taken captive and led astray. Can you read?
7. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth.
Ever learning. These people are ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Over there, Paul on Mars Hill came upon the Athenians, and they were always trying to come up on a new idea of what is good for doctrine. Any new thing. They always wanted something new. They were always trying to seek perfection, but then they're ever learning, but they never come to the knowledge of the simplicity of Yahweh, who he gave it all to us. He showed it all to us, but they deny that power. We do the same thing, and we don't even know it sometimes. You don't know it until it's revealed to you. I'll say it that way. You just don't know it. I've done it. And, you know, I'm not proud of it. But we come to this school to learn something about the purpose, the pattern, and plan of Yahweh. And it's a very good thing when Yahweh shows you something. And you hold on to that thing. It's 1 Thessalonians 5:21. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. You hold on to the things that are good. Keep them all together. You prove every single solitary thing that you deal with in your life. Now, once you got some proof of something, something concrete, you've got some evidence as to how it, whether it's true or not, then you got something to work with. And that's why we got these charts. And the beautiful thing about this school that's been set up is that everything, it shows forth that everything in the scriptures and everything in the creation fits right together. That's what the previous speaker was trying to get across by showing the steps of all in the elementary chart. And over here on this tabernacle, the man-made by the pattern chart, he's trying to show you that everything that we're teaching down here is according to a pattern. And we do that to show you that all this takes your picture. Sure, everything in the scriptures goes according to the pattern, which is something that you've never heard before out there in the world. But we'll go further to say everything in your life goes according to the pattern. And we're endeavoring to show you that pattern, or show you what we have come to understand about that pattern, hopefully hoping that you will prove these things and hold on to the things that are good about what has been spoken from the floor here by the vessels laboring to do so. What do we got? I was talking about idols. And how we can't afford to be taken captive by these things that we think we know about Yahweh. And we have to try to be conscious of the ever presence of Yahweh in our existence. I've been listening to a lot of the new SoundCloud videos that have been released, recordings. Yeah, the tapes have been released, and the sound audio quality is just as good as anything that you got on a recorder today. And I tell you, listening to Dr. Kinley, the founder of this school, break down the principles of what he's trying to get across, what his purpose for having this school is good for you. You can really, really learn something about why we're supposed to be down here from listening to those recordings. And he speaks quite frequently about becoming conscious of the ever presence of Yahweh. And that's what I was talking about the threefold nature, about the unity of the spirit. You can't have Yahweh in pure spirit You can't have Yahshua the Messiah without Yahweh Elohim being made manifest. You can't have Yahweh Elohim being made manifest without Yahweh pure spirit. Mm-hmm. It occurred to me yesterday when I was thinking about the Mars rover that they sent out, NASA sent out, for all of this money that they sent out trying to find signs of life on another planet. Like, you see the planet, don't you? If you understand something about spirit or matter is spirit being made manifest. So just seeing Mars is a sign of life. Just seeing it. It's not the life that you want. It's not organic matter. It's not what you want it to be. Your idolatry is what I mean. Because it doesn't breathe, it's not life. But the earth, we say, is alive. Just the earth itself. We say, but I'll say it this way, and I've heard it said many times before, that matter is spirit made manifest. And Mars, the planet Mars, is a mass of matter out in space. So seeing that, and seeing that how the constellations in the stellar universe is all according to the pattern, when I look out into space with a telescope or with my bare naked eyes, I see life. Yahweh said he is the light that shines in the darkness, and the darkness comprehends it not. And I get deep into thought when I think about that, because I realize that my physical body is made up of all of the elements of, you know, the earth. And there had to be something that breathed into this, that inspired this lump of flesh to animate and start moving. And without that something that inspired this body, then it's pretty dark inside of here. And I'm looking out into the camera, people out there, they're looking back at me. I see light. I see the light of this right here. But the reality of it, Yahweh has to reveal that to you. There's light. But the darkness, the ignorance of the idolatries that we all have placed in what we think is real causes us to be in darkness, not comprehending the light that is Yahweh, that lights the soul of the man. And I ponder on that. You know, I look at that. It's a very beautiful thing to have been revealed something about, you know, the purpose, this pattern, and how we operate according to it, and how everything else out there, you know, that's outside of this lump of flesh operates according to this pattern. And I can have some kind of comfort in knowing that the same thing that's going on here is going on here, that's going on here, and it can't be any different here or here or here. And like it said in the moderation, how it's explained that we draw the cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh, meaning that you can't get outside of Yahweh, meaning that Yahweh is always there. He's always there, operating according to a pattern. And we want you to investigate and find something out about that pattern so that you can come to a conscious realization of the ever presence of Yahweh. Now, I think that's good for me for today, and I'm going to take my floor and let the next speaker finish up for the day. If anything was said that was understood, all praises be to Yahweh. For our next speaker, our final speaker, I would like to call the president of the Ontario branch, Dr. Christopher Williams.
Good afternoon, class.
Good afternoon.
I do this every time I sweat. I shoot myself when I put this thing on. As always, it's a pleasure and honor. It's like no one over here. I'm going to be looking over here all day. It's a pleasure and honor to stand before you to give you a little something of what was given to me by this great gospel. And I do appreciate the first two speakers. Aaron actually made me ponder something that I just assumed. I didn't assume anything. I'll just get into it. So when I was a kid and I learned how to do the moderation, I think it was about, even before I did the moderation, I remember the very first time in, was it like 1987, 1988 or something like that, we were going to class in Pasadena. And the very first time I heard the moderation, I was kind of like, man, this is interesting. It's all these things going on in here, right? Because my dad didn't really explain to me what was going on. He just figured, let him hit it and then talk to him afterwards. We'll sort through the mess afterwards. And they got to the name, and I had never heard anyone talk about Lord God and Jesus Christ in such a way that it just diminished it. And as a eight-year-old kid, it just resonated like, wait, what do you mean there's no J? I thought it was a joke. And so my dad says, he goes, so what you think? I said, there's no J? There's no J? And I'm literally just losing my mind about this. And he goes, hey, here's a dictionary. Because at the time, my dad carried every dang book on the planet because we only had like four. And so he had the dictionary, and he had a version of the one that we have now. And I read it. And I said, wow, this is crazy. It was no J. I'm like, because I looked it up, and then we, you know, we went and looked up an encyclopedia and saw there's no J and all this whole stuff. And I started looking up Yahweh. I couldn't find Yahshua because there was a whole lot of writings. But I just remember, you know, this is wow. So then Aaron, you know, some 20-some years later, gets on the floor and talking about the J. And it made me think, because now I'm a critical thinker. And I said, what about the word jump? It's been around for years. What about jealous? Give me Exodus 20 and 5, 20 and 4.
Exodus 24. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven idol or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, Yahweh, thy Elohim, am a jealous Elohim.
What word?
Jealous.
So, if Yahweh's saying the word jealous, Lucy, you have some explaining to do, right? So, I'm sitting there thinking to myself, ha ha ha, gotcha. I'm sitting on my seat contradicting this gospel. And then I get up and go get out the dictionary and I look up the word jealous. It was originally zealous. I was like, well, got you again, right? So, and if you go look through the dictionary, it tells you the about the year when it was created. And I think the farthest back, and I thought for sure I was going to win with jealous because I knew it was in the Bible, right? You see jealous all the time, right? And, you know, common words that you use, like what did they use for jump? They didn't use the word jump. They said something else. It was just crazy. So there's all these words that we use now that we take for granted that we just didn't know wasn't in existence eons ago. It just seems like common knowledge. It's like something you use in language, but it wasn't. And so because, you know, you made the statement, oh, people don't just research on the fly. No, we do. We just have the ability to do it better now. Like right now. And so when I read that, I was like, wow. And if you look at the dates, I think the farthest back was like 1575 for a word. And it gives you all the words that was used before that. It gives you the synonyms or whatever was used prior to. And if you look up Jesus, you know, you'll see Iesus and all that stuff. And it tells you that. And just in the etymology of the word in the dictionary. And so it just made me wonder. And so, you know, you sit there and say, I haven't gone very far. I haven't been here long. But in simplicity, you always learn something. It doesn't even matter. So there's no big I's or little U's in this gospel. It's just either you get it or you don't. And something's revealed to you when it needs to be revealed to you. And I just thought that was an interesting thing. But a couple other things that were brought up on the floor, I just want to address and take my seat and call class. But it was talked about with Genesis 1:26.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image after our likeness.
Right.
And let them rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens.
So now, when you break down those two scriptures, it says, let us. And Elohim said, let us make man after our image and after our likeness. And the us, when you understand these names, it's not talking about these three manifestations, these two manifestations. It's not what's saying, okay? Right. And I want to make sure that's clear. When you use the word Elohim, when you look it up, it's actually a pluralistic name. Eloah is the singular form, and Elohim is recognizing, just like when Yahweh, Elohim, Yahweh in itself is both masculine and feminine, yet neither. Now, when it comes to when he created the creation, it didn't take all of Yahweh to create Yahweh Elohim, but in part transformed or transmuted into what you see and what you do. As this is a creation, so that both male and feminine portion of himself created a creation in principle, to point out that when we create a creation, it takes one male and one female to create a creation. Whether you're transgender, lesbian, gay, super straight, whatever the case may be. I mean, we got it all now. I mean, we just ever evolving. But it takes both different, either male and female, to come together to create creation. Likewise, when he moved on the face of the earth, that was Yahweh in his masculine form impregnating Mother Earth. Likewise, when Gabriel overshadowed Mary, he impregnated her with the spirit of the living Elohim. It's all the same. Okay, so I just wanted to address that because it came out, and I just figured maybe need a little more explanation. But it's important that we understand these things. And something I've learned over the years is that words matter, and how we use those words matter just as much. And we get in the habit of using words and forgetting that how we present those words and what's said and the manner in which we say it, how it affects one person. Because if my wife or girlfriend or whoever I'm with says, "How does this dress make me look?" how I respond back better be, you know, appropriate, or else it could create a stir. I could say, "Oh, you look okay." Or I can be like, "Man, you look okay." Or I can be like, "You look okay." I'm saying the same words, but how I'm presenting it is totally different. You know, and when we get on the floor or we talk to someone about this gospel, we don't, the words that we use matter in how we present this information, because you don't know how you're being perceived. And the great thing about this gospel is, as it was stated before, the truth doesn't need your help. It presents itself in a way that is irrefutable. It's infallible. And it makes it so that you can come up with whatever spin you want, but the truth is spin free. It's a no spin zone, right? You can't get around that. So when we present this gospel in its simplicity and we talk about the pattern and why the seven steps, one, that they exist, and then we start to explain the significance and why they matter, that's when people start to fall off as far as their lies and their half-truths and, you know, what they think is truth versus what is facts. Because people want to talk about their opinions about this gospel. That, let's say, Christians, they're really good to refute because they're always a lot of fun. They like to get into your feels. They want to talk about how you feel about the gospel. And it's easy to get caught up in your feelings because Satan uses your feelings to cloud your judgment so you can't see what's actually happening. You know, my dad used to present to me, he's always telling me that feelings are illusions. I used to be like, "Man, what kind of cockamamie stuff is that? Like, who says that?" And he used to say it all the time, but he would never explain himself because he just, you know, for me, he just figured, "You're a Williams, you'll get it." Well, I didn't get it. I was like, "Man, what are you talking about?" And then one day, he explained it. I'm like, "All right, I can see that." And, you know, let's just take this thing called love. I have a better one. Let's anger. Something we all deal with on a regular basis. Now, anger in and of itself is not bad. But when you let your anger get the best of you, meaning you let it direct your movements, that's when it becomes bad. In anger, if he steps on my foot and I react in anger and I lash out and hit him back, even though I don't find out why or how he stepped on my foot, I'm in the wrong. Because I didn't give him an opportunity to fix that situation. He might have misstepped because he's trying to avoid stepping on his coffee. And my foot just happened to be out there. "Oh, man, I'm sorry," and stepping your foot. But before I can get him a chance to say I'm sorry, I just react in anger. I always lose. I used to see someone, and I would tell them all the time, like, "You're so angry, and you let your anger get the best of you." Every time, 100% of the time you react in anger, you lose 100% of the time. I've never seen anyone just have an angry outburst and they win. Never. They call Karens now, right? No, I'm serious. That's their emotions getting the best of them because they feel so strongly about a thing that they forget to compose themselves and they let that illusion that they're in the right get them on the wrong path. It's not to say that Yahweh don't get angry. I believe he displayed that anger with these Israelites when he built this golden calf, did he not? But he didn't act in anger because he just lost his composure. Before this happened, he rained down some rules. Say, hey, this is the new covenant between you and me. In fact, we just read it. Go ahead, we might as well go back and get it. It's the very first one. We just read it, didn't we? About graven idols, 20 and 4.
Galatians. You want me to start at 4?
Anybody, 20 and 4.
Okay. Oh, geez, I just went to the wrong. I'm sorry. I lost it. I was on the right page, and I went to the wrong. There we go. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven idol or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth.
So we have a bunch of Israelites down here who lost faith and let their emotions get the best of them. They believed the illusion that they were out here to die and that they needed some savior that they need to conjure up to worship. Even though they heard the law get thundered down from a cloud. Listen, I see a cloud thundering something to me. I'm like, I'm good. I don't need no graven idol. But that's just me. I might have been different back here. It's hard. It's easy to be a Monday morning quarterback when we're reading this stuff. But when you're there, what's everybody doing? Oh, we doing what? You need my gold? I mean, that's what they was doing. They literally just, you know, building this golden calf to worship it. Even though they just agreed to not do that. And to the outside people, you know, anybody reading this thing would think, oh, man, that Yahweh, he's mean. No. He set a rule in place. Did he not have a covenant? If you broke this law, you died in front of two or three witnesses. So it wasn't like he was acting out of anger. But it would appear to be that way. But the fact of the matter is, what we do, we don't have these laws that we present to other people. We don't present laws to people and then be like, don't break them. We don't do that. Somebody sees someone not wearing a mask and, oh, you need to wear a mask. It's like, why don't you mind your own business? You need to cut your beard. Lady, if you don't sit down, that's what we do. Why is he taking a knee during the national anthem? Who cares? Because we get in our heads that we need to express ourselves. You said this world is crazy. It is. I can't remember a time where saying something, anything, 20 years ago could come back and bite you in the butt this bad. I guess it's called cancel culture, whatever you want to call it. And the crazy part is there is a way around it, but you know, people fall so prey to pressure because they let their illusions or their emotions get the best of them, and they allow the canceling to occur. Very rarely do you see people just be like, nah, that's not going down. They just tried to cancel Eminem recently, right? Mm-hmm. And he said, not today. I'm not going to even give you any power in that. He just kept on moving. And that's how you get through that. You don't acknowledge it. You know, people just, like, same person. Hey, they said such and such about me. Okay, is it true? No. So then what are you defending it for?
Yeah, really.
Now, the people that have to defend what they did means they actually did it. Because if there's no truth to it, you don't sweat it. Like, I've been accused of when I was Raymond's, you know, I was going through a custody battle with Raymond's mom, it's my oldest son's mom. She had accused me of domestic violence. She went to court, told the judge that I did XYZ. I wasn't even there to defend myself. And when I go to court, I'm like, hey, I just got this note saying that you guys are taking my kid from me? Well, yes, sir, you was accused of such and such and such and such. I'm like, was I here to defend it? And they're like, no. Well, then why are you agreeing to it? And listen, to make a long story short, I had to go back to court after losing my son for 6 weeks. And I went to court, and they said, well, you said such and such. I said, miss, I'm not going to even dignify that claim with a response because I haven't been charged. I haven't gone to jail. and there's no one prosecuting me. So what are we talking about? Oh, okay, never mind. We take it all back. But from that decision was a litany of nonsense that occurred to my children because of that action. But guess what they didn't do? Hit me with some domestic violence nonsense. Because you don't feed the beast. That's not what you do.
Mm-hmm. True.
The moment you start defending yourself is when, yeah, mm-hmm. you did it. Like, all these claims about, you know, Harvey Weinstein, he's tap dancing, ducking, and dodging because he did it. If Harvey Weinstein didn't do anything wrong, he'd be like, man, I don't know what they're talking about, and just keep on rolling. But he can't do that. There's too much evidence pointing that he did it. They couldn't deny that this happened. I mean, one, there's a big giant golden calf sitting there staring him in the face. It is what it is. But the point is, we have so many people who are just allowing these things to get the best of them because of emotions. When it came to Adam and Eve, Lucifer got hurt with her emotions. Why don't we just get it? Maybe I'm just making this stuff up. Was it 3 and 1?
Genesis 3:1.
Mm-hmm.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which Yahweh Elohim had made.
Read.
And he said unto the woman, has Elohim said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
Now, you know, Yahweh is amazing when you think about it, what he does. And to describe the characteristics of a serpent and then have that be Lucifer in this story, it's pretty good. It's genius. And if you've seen a cobra and how they do their thing, they sway back and forth and get their prey to kind of like start swaying with them, and they hypnotize them in a way, and they put them in a trance. And just as that prey is like, oh, he starts swaying with them, the serpent knows, gotcha, wah, and then he attacks. And by then, you're in such a trance, you don't have enough time to react, and you're just getting eaten, and you don't even know how it happened. That's all he's doing. He's eating. And so he sees Eve, and he says, what was the law that Elohim gave you? Go ahead and read it.
And he said unto the woman, has Elohim said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, mm-hmm. but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
And the crazy thing is, she was doing so good up until that point. Like, yeah, we can't eat that fruit. We can eat everything else, but we can't touch that. Now, the only reason why Lucifer used that fruit to get her is because he knows that she's been wondering about what that fruit's all about. She's been building something up inside looking at that fruit. Now, my dad did a good job with this one. He says she looked at it, right? You know, Adam walked by and like, I don't think nothing of it because he know better, right? But Eve walks by, she's like, man, it looks really good. I want some. We do that all the time, right? I mean, we really do. Women walk by that Versace store, man, I really want that purse, right? Guys walk by that Crystal Spa place, but man, I really want to know what's going on in there, you know? Come on, that was funny. Not to Samuel. He's like, man, what you talking about? He's Adam. Stand fast. My point is, she saw that fruit. She's like, man, I wonder what that thing tastes like. But she don't taste it because she knows better, right? And next you know, Lucifer starts talking to her a little bit more. What does he say?
Oh. And the serpent said unto the woman, no death will you die.
Right.
For Elohim doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, mm-hmm. and ye shall be as Elohim, mm-hmm. knowing good and evil.
Now, here you got Eve, who knows the law understands the law, but she's been questioning the law, and now he's praying on it. And he says, no death will you die. Mm-hmm. He's deceiving her. You know, people think, oh, he lied to her. No, he did not lie. That's the crazy part. He hit her right with the truth. You're not going to die. At least not in the way you think. See, he can't have his way with her until he can separate her from Yahweh. He's attempting to get her emotional about this dang fruit. See, we let our emotions get the best of us. We get so wrapped up in how we feel about something, we forget to think about something. Sometimes our head and our heart don't always work together. Right? See, Yahweh was trying to get us back to having a heart and mind that work together. See, right now, this makes you have to think about the law, and then sometimes you get emotional about the law because it's separate. It's not something that, you know, you get this thing in your mind that, oh, I got to do this like a robot. And then sometimes you get them like, man, I just don't feel like it. And that's when they get in trouble. Well, here, she didn't feel like following the law because now he's got her thinking about it. And really and truly, this is happening in her head. There is no serpent, and Lucifer is not out sitting there having a conversation. This is something that's going on internally. Mm-hmm. That's how Satan works. Remember, he's not a physical being. He's an angel.
Right.
How do angels present themselves? Their thoughts. Right? You have good thoughts. You have bad thoughts, and you have good thoughts. You always that he's always that angel says, man, you don't want to go down that road. You might want to take it left instead of a right. How many times you've been, man, I'm going to walk down the street, and someone tells you, man, don't go that way. And you're like, yeah, I'm going to go this way. I do it all the time. She's having those thoughts right now. Read.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, mm-hmm. and that it was pleasant to the eyes, mm-hmm. and a tree to be desired to make one wise.
So she saw that it looked good. Then she created a desire for it. Now she's gotten this emotional desire to just, I got to have it. We do that all the time, right? They do it to kids all the time. Saturday morning cartoons. They watching some Pokemon. Next you know, here comes this ice cream at Cold Stone. Like, you just got to have it. They even have a size. It's called got to have it. That's how they roll. They tempt you with a desire, and you've had ice cream before, but Cold Stone, tell me Cold Stone ain't different than some regular store-bought dryers. You get mix-ins. Get to put in the shake if you want to. Your desires are just percolating now. Man, she said it looks good. Now she desires it. It makes you wise? Crazy thing is she was already wise. She didn't even know it. One of the attributes that was let us make man after our image and after our likeness was wisdom one of them.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
She already had that which she had, what she desired. Don't we do that all the time? Mm-hmm. We're in a relationship. A good relationship, but we think something's better over there. I'm going to go over here. But you had great here. But because we get so mapped up in our emotions, we get blinded by the truth. We let our good thoughts get silenced and we start listening to the nonsense. That's what happens, right? And so we start desiring something that which we already have, but somewhere else. And that's when we get tripped up. This has been happening for eons, right? This is not just something that's happened in the last 25, you know, mm-hmm. years.
Right.
It's been happening since the dawn of time. We've been having these desires for something that's pleasures of the flesh, right? Mm-hmm. Read. We're almost done.
Desire to make one wise.
Uh-huh.
She took of the fruit thereof, mm-hmm. and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
Now, she took of the fruit. And it's like, I realize, yeah, I probably shouldn't have done that. Hey, Adam, why don't you try this? Now she's trying to get somebody else in this mix with her. And he's sitting there watching this whole thing unfold. Like, God, dog, I got to go do this. Because he already knows. He knows something about to go down. And then he goes, all right, dang it. It's pretty good, but yeah, we're going to regret that. And next thing you know, it starts to get cooler in the day. The sun starts moving. Life starts happening. Now, I said all that to say two things. One, we can't let our emotions get the best of us. They are illusions, not in a bad way. Emotions are there to let you know that, hey, something is about to happen. You need to be on your A game. Because if you're not on your A game, you succumb to your emotions, and now you're presenting yourself in a way that gets you in trouble. They got in trouble. Now, this was according to a purpose. He's right. There are a lot of bad things happening in this world. But if that event doesn't happen, you and I don't exist. That's a bad thing that happened. But from that, life sprung out, and we were saved because there was a salvation plan in operation. We just didn't know it. Likewise, there's a lot of bad things happening right now. And we did have 4 years of a really crazy person. And listen, he let the entire world know you're all nuts because half the world was sitting there saying, hey, he's great. The other house was like, I cannot believe this is happening. And it just let everyone know we're fractured as a society. And it's incumbent upon everyone that's watching this to make different decisions about our children, about our education, about how we give back to others. What's our next move? That's going to be what's going to happen next. What's going to happen in this class? What's going to happen in this organization? Are we making decisions based on the past? Are we looking at what's present? Are we actually planning for the future? What are we doing? That's why these events happen. Someone wonders, how come so many bad things are happening to good people? They're happening for a reason. Bad things happen to bad people, but no one cares. I'm just being honest with you. We only care when it happens to good people. If a group of gangsters ran off the road and died and fall off a cliff and died at their death, they'd be like, well, they had that coming. And nobody bats an eye. But it's only news when Marlon and his great family gets ran off the road. Like, how could that happen to such a great family, right? And then everyone wants to go up in arms and start a GoFundMe page for the family and the whole nine yards. That's just the way our society is. It sucks. But that's the way it was set up. Because we can't play on these emotions if it's happening to him. No one cares. But when it's happening to him, everyone cares. Cancel culture. I literally can't make this up. Some people are getting canceled, bad people. And then when good people start getting canceled, it's like, whoa, no, not our hero. Yeah, it's just letting you know everyone has flaws. Everybody. There are no perfect people. Well, maybe Samuel, but that's another story. I hope and trust you got something with set on the floor today. Thank you very much. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. That will conclude today's lecture. Do we have any announcements today? No? Okay. So we hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m., and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. We do apologize for the late delay today. We had some technical difficulties, but we will conclude on time. Thank you all for coming out to study with us, and please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place to learn something about your Creator. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology, taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm. And Wendy having a conversation.